Okay, very well. So, now that we know what we need to do, we are going to become a little bit more formal, and I'm going to go again very fast through what we already know, because I already give you the fundamentals, for example, for you already know what is a one form, you already know what is a vector. I will going to give you a little more details about the metric and the vector and their relationship, because there are a few details you should still know that I didn't mention. And then we will introduce some new object, which is crucial for physics in general, as a whole, not only in GR, which are tensors. Because tensors, you find them everywhere. You find them in electrodynamics. You find them in GR. For example, the metric is a tensor. Therefore, we need to know how to manage and manipulate these sort of objects. And now, what I tried to do up to now was to convince you and to show you why we need all of that. Okay, so usually people start the way around, gives you a bunch of mathematics, and they're like, "Boo, what for?" Okay, and then you arrive at the physics. I try to do a little bit of mixture such that you know why we are doing what we are doing. Okay, so now it'll be formal, maximum concentration, because this is going to be the language that we are going to use through the rest of the lectures. Okay, good. So let's start with vectors, one forms, and tensors. So we are back to this sort of objects. I just remind you what a vector is. A vector is an object which is extremely abstract, could be a polynomial. Okay? So it has to obey certain rules. But it's not something that is extended from one point to another, as we are kind of used to draw it, but it's something that exists in one point, okay? And it has no components. And it exists in one point, okay? If I draw a point particle here, and I want to describe the velocity, what I do? I draw an arrow, okay? This is the velocity of our particle. But does it mean that the velocity is going from here to here? No, this is the velocity of the particle here. If I describe the wind in this position, I can draw an arrow that looks like it's going from here to there, but actually is the velocity of the wind here. Therefore, I can define a vector space as the collection of all vectors. So this is a vector space in one point, okay? So one point can contain an infinite number of vectors. This is a vector space in that point. Now, it was not relevant to make this clarification with GR because the properties of the basis, of the vectors, and so on into the entire four-dimensional space, into the Minkowski space, were the same. So a position here is exactly equivalent to another position. That's not going to be anymore the case when we're going to deal with curved spacetimes, when we're going to deal with curved manifolds. Okay? So that's why I'm stressing this point. Then we can introduce a basis set. Where E is the index identifying the vector of the basis. The vector E belongs to the vector space, which is the set of vectors that we can use to express vectors as linear combination of the basis. For now that we have the vectors, we can define the components of our vector, so our vector V, which doesn't have components. Once we introduce a basis set, we can express it in terms of linear combination of the basis in this way. Okay? And now you know why we are putting the index up, because we are dealing with vectors, not with one forms. Then we can transform from, we can apply a transformation for our coordinate system. In which these vectors can be expressed with other vectors. I can use another set of bases, but still the vector is going to be the vector. Because, as I said, vectors have no components. This is the abstract object. And once we introduce one basis, could be this one, we can introduce another basis, we have this one. Different coefficients, but same vector. Okay? Now, how does a transformation look like? Well, we need to define a function that gives us the final, that combines, so we are basically define a function, get a bit more space here, so let's stick to that. So we define a function that swallows the old coordinates with some affine parameter, okay? And return us the coefficient in the new frame. So this is a function of the old coordinate frame. This is just the result of the transformation applied to our coordinates. Okay? I could write here f. Okay? So that's the function that does the transformation. For simplicity, it's usually written with the same name of the index for which that relates to that transformation. Okay? Can you see that? Good. Now what we do? We want to see the transformation, therefore we want to basically associate an infinitesimal change of our coordinates to the corresponding infinitesimal change of the new coordinates. Therefore, we just apply we compute the derivative with respect to the affine parameter associated to the coordinate, tau. Chain rule, because it's a function of a function, as you can see. Therefore, we just have the xe prime over the xj. And then we have the xj over the tau. Oh, actually, yes. Okay? If we forget about the tau, what we have, the xe prime is equal to the xe prime over the xj, the xe. Which is the prototype of a vector. And gives you the transformation of an infinitesimal length to another infinitesimal length. So you see that the coordinate transformation, which here we see the Jacobian of the transformation, is going to tell us what is the infinitesimal change while we change in one coordinate when we change infinitesimally the other coordinate. Okay? And look that now what we are dealing with is not with the Lorentz transformations that I always label with this lambda, but this is any transformation. This is valid for any transformation. And we express the Lorentz transformation in the very same way. Okay? So from now on, keep in mind that we are working with any transformation that can be expressed in this way. Okay? So to derive the Lorentz transformation, what we did? We used that, and then we imposed the property that the Minkowski metric must be invariant. Okay? And this gave us the transformation which is associated. We constructed the association given, the transformation given that that constraint. And now you see this dx, don't get confused, because then, since this is a vector, this is applied to any vector, for the xe prime the x j, sorry, this is a j. Yeah? It's this summatory here, and the only free index is the prime. Okay, so that's the transformation of vector, given any transformation. Then what is the transformation of the basis? We can transform the basis as well. They must transform, because if this guy changes, this one must change as well, such that the result is always the same, right? Therefore, the two, we already can intuitively understand that they should kind of compensate each other. And this tells us that the transformation of basis is not the same as the transformation of vectors. So we have our two frames, S and S prime, to which we can associate two basis sets, E and E, E prime. And of course, we know that they are going to be represented by two different basis vector, cioè by the same vector can be expressed as a linear combination of the first basis in E prime, or as a linear combination in the prime system. They are the same, right? B is B. Then what we do, we want to find out how the basis transform. Therefore, we use the fact that these two ways of writing the same vector must be the same. Therefore, I just write it here once more. We have the vector expressed in this way. But this one is equal to V, E, A, E prime, and prime. And now what I can do, I can plug in the transformation for the prime vector that we have from here. Now I'm going to use lambda for the transformation, but this, remember, it can be any transformation. It's just this dx over the x e prime over the xj. And it's going to be E prime E V E A E. But the transformation is linear, so I can bring this guy in front, right? Therefore, we can have our expression for the transformed basis. That is V E that I brought in front. And then we have E prime, E, E, E. Prime and prime. You see, VE, VE, E, and the transformation. Therefore, we have the link for the transformation of our basis. And you see that the basis transform the way around. Then we can define the inverse of the transformation. This is the transformation from prime, from S prime to S. We can look at the inverse transformation. And we can just write it as the inverse of our transformation, lambda to the minus one. And then we have the indexes, J prime and E, for instance, which is quite inconvenient to carry around. Okay, so this is a way of writing stuff. There is no mathematics going here. I'm just saying that the lambda minus one and the indices, I can simply write it as lambda, J prime, and E. So I remove the minus one here, and I flip the indices. So careful, because this is quite subtle. Okay, so if you see the indices warped like this, it means that it is the inverse of the transformation. And to find the transformation, we just need to apply it to this guy, so that we kind of, you know, we go backward. So we have J prime E applied to E, I used E, and then we have the same stuff on the other side, E, and then E prime, E, and E, E prime. But since we are going, so you see I just applied the inverse transformation to this term, that's what we have, and to this term, that's what we have. Okay? But this is the inverse of this equation, therefore that's equal to E prime. And that's our transformation. For that's the inverse transformation. Okay? Now let's explore, and again, remember that now lambda is any transformation, okay? Can be anything, not just the Lorentz. Yes?
Why is E I prime
and not E J prime? The two are repeated up and down here. No.
I mean, on the
right side, like this.
On the right
side, E J
prime as well.
So. Wait. E. No, that's E. E, that's J. Oh, God. No, that's E. That's E. It's prime. E, J, okay. Okay, now it works. And this is J. Okay. Good. Okay. Good. Let's now continue with the metric. And let's investigate this object a little bit better. So you know that the metric is expressing the scalar product between vector and defines various quantities such as differences, modulus of vectors, and so on. And now, forget about a specific metric. We are going to use any metric, G. Okay? Is any metric. And you see now why it's so important to use any metric. And G, as we have seen already, is actually a bilinear map, which is swallowing two vectors and is spitting out a real number. It gives you a scalar. We can write it as UV, where these are the two vectors that are swallowed. And we get GUV, which is defined as UV, the scalar product. And U and V are belonging to the vector space that we are describing. And A is a real number. Okay, this you already know. Then what are the properties? Is non-null. Which means that G U V is equal to zero for every U belonging to the vector space if and only if V is equal to zero. Okay? So whenever you apply a metric to V equals zero and you get zero for every U, then this means that the metric is not null, non-null metric, is not degenerate. Not degenerate. Then it allows you to define the modulus of vectors, the norm of vectors. Because if we get G and we apply it to the same vector twice, this gives us the norm squared. Then the components, you know how to get them. I already showed you, but just for completeness. So if we have our metric G, the components are basically, again, we are swallowing two vectors that can be expressed as a linear combination of the bases. Therefore, we have the U, I, E, I bar, V, J, E, J bar. But G, as we said, is a bilinear map. Therefore, by taking advantage of the linearity of this mapping, these are just two numbers that can come out of our metric. Therefore, we have U, E, V, J applied to G, E, 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 J. And this guy here is our coefficient G, E, J. Then G is a symmetric. And as I already showed you with an example, now we see it formally. This fact is related by the fact that the four interval, or the n interval, because we are dealing with an arbitrary vector space now, is has a quadratic form. So as G, I, E, J. And then we have the x, e, the x, j. You see, it is quadratic form. And what we can do is to basically swap the two, g, I, j, I keep it as it is, the x, j, the x, e. Okay, I can swap them, they're just two numbers, I can swap them with no problems. But then, what we can do is relabel. You see, these are dummy indices. I can relabel them, and what we can basically get, have G, E, J, the X, J, the X, E. That I can now flip back, so that I have E and J as before. This shows you that the metric is symmetric, and this is given. Basically, the very nature of this is given by the fact that these are just two numbers that you can flip, okay? Just by the quadratic structure of the interval. Then a little bit of nomenclature. If the S square is strictly, so is positive definite, so it's equal to zero or larger than zero, then we're talking about a Riemannian space. If the S square can be smaller than zero, larger than zero, equal to zero, then it's called pseudo-Riemannian, pseudo. I mentioned this name because maybe you find textbooks and they just say, we are dealing with a Riemannian space. We are dealing with that or that else, okay? And if they don't explain, now, I mean, you have a meaning attached to it. Okay, so that's about the metric. Then we have the one forms. That I already introduced, but for example, I didn't show you how they transform. So now we are going to do that. One forms that are also called dual vectors, that are also called co-vectors, that are also called cotangent vectors. And they are also called covariant vectors, by the way. Okay? All this stuff are the same object. Okay? They have different names because they were used in different contexts within mathematics, and they acquired different names, but they are the same thing. As we have seen, they represent a linear map that is swallowing a vector, and it's spitting out a real number. So you can find it written with the star. That's when they are called dual map. Or just for convenience, I use, instead of a straight stick, I'm using kind of a tilde. Okay? Because I don't like to carry around this asterisk thing. Okay, so that's a linear map. It's swallowing a vector, and it's going to give you a real number. Therefore, if we are swallowing a vector u, we are getting a real number. And this thing, as we have seen, is defined as gu v. That, as I showed you before, this is nothing but the scalar product that gives you a real number. Okay? And u and v, as before, they are vector in the, they are vectors of the vector space we are dealing with. And basically, our one form is this guy here. We have vector times matrix times vector. And this is the first bit of computation, and we call it one form. And careful, our one form V doesn't belong to the vector space. It belongs to the dual space, or to the space of one forms. Use the name as you want. Okay? They don't live in the same vector space. Objects live in the same vector space. If you make a linear combination of those two objects, you still obtain a vector of the same nature. Okay? If you have two polynomials of a certain nature, you make the linear combination, you still get a polynomial of the same nature. If you are making a vector plus a covariant vector, doesn't make sense, okay? You don't get a vector or a covariant vector. You have something that doesn't make sense. So they are living in different vector spaces. Now, let's look at the components. And how it's as well related to the index lowering. Put them together to be a bit faster. But we get to find out what is the component. We do exactly what we did for the metric. We just let our one form act on what our linear map of what it's swallowing, a vector. And then we express the vector in terms of its linear combination of a basis. Again, same business, is a linear object. We bring it the u, e in front. And this guy here is the component of our object. You can see the indexes, how they are all the time respected. But as well, we know that this guy is the scalar product, as I wrote up there. Therefore, I can write it as well, I can write it as well in this way. And what? Now I can use just the representation that we did up there for the metric, as well for the vectors. So we know that the matrix is G. Ij, these are the components that we derived up there. Then we have vector E, another vector, UE. And you see that actually this guy must be equal to that. They must be equal. It means that, so let's do it this. So you see that basically GIJVE UJ is equal to V E U E. This is the index lowering. If you have a vector, you apply the metric to it, you get this guy with an index low. Sorry, J and J. Okay, that's index low. And you see how it is connected to the definition of the component of a vector. Sorry, I need to drink. And what I want to tell you. And now that we have that, so you see that we have expressed one form as a linear linear mapping, you can just realize, you see you have V that goes from a vector to a real number, and we can write it as G V U equal to V tilde U. We could have done exactly the same stuff for the vectors. Why not? It's just a matter of having an index up and down. Therefore, I can as well see a vector as a linear mapping of one forms into real number, because we have exactly the same structure. You see? And this kind of makes sense because we have objects that have the same degrees of freedom, so to say, because they are, if we have one forms and vectors belonging to a vector space with the same dimension, we can transform one with another through the metric. They're still carrying in the same information. So you see that it's not that one form is sort of different with respect to vectors. They are kind of objects that are both linear mapping, that they are both doing the same thing. One is acting on one forms, the other one is acting on vectors. Yes? Yes. This is still the form. This is still the one form. We go from this vector space of one forms to real numbers. Okay. And now that we see that there is this similarity, you see, that kind of the same stuff. For vectors, we can define a basis set. We can define a basis set for one forms as well. Because for vectors, we know that we can write vector as VE and E. We want to do the same for one forms. So if we have a one form like this, we want to define something similar, but we know that the components of the one forms have the index below. Therefore, if we want to keep the same sort of representation, we have our basis for one form that must have the index up. Okay, so we have and if we are talking about components, for the E form, the jth component. So this is an index identifying the one form, this identifies the component of that basis. Component. Okay? Like for the vector basis, but they are the basis of vector, but they are with the index flipped. So let's try to see how they look like, how they should look like in a Cartesian frame. So again, what we do, we get our one form and we apply it to a vector that we now express as a linear we want to express this as a linear combination. Therefore, we have VE and our basis, and then we do the same with this guy, with that expression. So we have UE and E, and that's our vector set. But this is a linear map, therefore I can bring U and put it in front. Therefore I have UE, let's use J, sorry, different index so we make confusion. J, and we have omega tilde E of A. Okay? But now look, this guy must be equal to V E U E, because that's what we were doing here, right? And what is going to tell you? That this guy must be equal to the Kronecker delta. This must be equal to delta. We need to transform this J into an E, therefore this must be equal to EJ. And the Kronecker delta is defined as dxE over dxJ. And this guy is our omega component E, index with E, component J. So what do you see? You see that basically one forms are sort of the prototypes of gradients. When we were looking at vectors, we found out when we did a transformation, where is it? Up there, where we got our dx. By the way, there is a dv here. That's a V, of course, that's the transformation of V. I just called the X equal to V. Okay? Just to give you a formal, kind of known way to see. So what you basically see is that the vectors were prototype of displacements, whereas one forms are the prototypes of gradients. Just one final remark. Take care when you look at the indexes, because for example, we get the basis set, two, okay? We have that this guy might have the components 0, 0, 1, and then all zeros, okay? And we might have a vector for the basis 2, which is equal to 0, 0, 1, and then all zeros. Am I done writing? No. Transposed. So the components are the same, but they are not the same thing. Okay? So take care of this as well. Good. We can stop here. I was almost there to complete the discussion about one form, but we are running late, so I prefer to stop here and let you free. And as you see, we are getting a little bit more formal. I'm giving you more details. And what we learned is that we are dealing now with completely arbitrary transformation of vectors. We know how to transform vectors in a completely arbitrary way. We know how to transform bases in a completely arbitrary way. We know how to write down the inverse of the transformation for the bases. That's very important. Take care about these indexes because it's very easy to mistake. We have seen more details about the metrics, about the properties of the metric. And we revised the one form, and on top of the definition, the construction that I gave you at the beginning, we learn how to derive the components, and also show you why the components of one forms looks like this with an index below. I'm giving you a better explanation of what the lower of the index lowering, where it's coming from. So that the metric is basically lowering the indexes of vectors, so this vector lowers the index to this transformation. I showed you that one forms and vector are kind of similar objects. They kind of have very similar properties. And as we then constructed the basis for vector, we wanted to do the same for one forms. And we derived how the basis set for one forms in Cartesian coordinate look like. Okay? We will continue next lecture, seeing one last bit of information between the connection between vectors and one form. And then we will show you tensors and how to transform them and how to manage them, what kind of operations they do, can do, outer product, inner product, and all of that. Okay? So thank you very much, and see you next time.